Thank you very much, and thank you for this invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. So my team has been working on the role of hedgehog proteins in different human pathologies since now almost 25 years. So, and more specifically, and a very big part of the work of the team is around cancer. So let's start by a small introduction about what are hedgehog proteins. Hedgehog proteins are stress proteins. They are induced by many different stress. They are very well conserved through evolution, and they have a pro-survival function. It's a mechanism of defense of the cells. They produce these proteins, and they avoid, and that allows the survival of the cell. They have a role as molecular chaperones, which means that they are going to interact with proteins that are malfolded or just have been synthesized, and they are going to prevent aggregation, to make that they have the correct folding, and that they go to the cellular compartment where they should go. And they have been traditionally classified in four families for the molecular weight, a family of small HSPs, HSP60 family, HSP70 family, and 90 family. Now I'm going to talk to you today about this chaperone. This has been included in this family because it started by a duplication of the HSP70. So many people included in this family, but it's a chaperone by its own with a very strong anti-aggregation function. So now, why to target hedgehog proteins in cancer therapy? In fact, a normal cell, normally they don't produce these stress-inducible chaperones. They only have, whenever there is some stress, they induce the chaperone and then they go to the basal level. In contrast, this is not the case of the cancer cells. Cancer cells, because they have to rewire the metabolism, they have a strong necessity of these chaperones. And thereby they are addicted to these chaperones, and they overexpress in the constitutional way these chaperones. So the inhibition helps the cancer cells to die. So this is the rationale to target these proteins in cancer. Let me give you an example with one that the chaperone that we have studied the most in my laboratory, which is HSP70. So normally in a cancer cell you have this quantity already much more than a normal cell. And on top of that, whenever you do a chemotherapy or any therapy, cancer therapy, there is an increase of these chaperones in the cancer cells, which means that it becomes resistant to the therapy and the therapy doesn't work anymore. But the HSPs also can have an extracellular location. They are secreted. And when they are secreted, they don't have anymore this role, the chaperone intracellular. The role is believed to be immunogenic, but also protective. What they do, these HSPs extracellular, is to activate immunosuppressive cells, and they block the clearance of the immune cells. The cancer cell is not anymore cleared by the immune system. So you see, we have a way of targeting an HSP, and we can target in one way on sensitizing the cell to the chemotherapy, and the other way on doing that now, an efficient anti-cancer immune response is going to be done. So we have two ways of fighting cancer in a simultaneous way. So this is for HSP70, but you are going to see that for HSP110, we have the same scenario, with a role intracellular and a role extracellular, always that ends us in the protection of the cancer cell. Now, HSP110 was a chaperone that until a discovery that we did in 2011, was not studied at all. Nobody knows almost hardly anything about this chaperone. So the discovery we did, it was that we found in colorectal cancers of the type that is called microsatellite unstable, we found that in all these patients, there was always a mutation of an HSP. And this HSP was HSP110. It is the only HSP ever found mutated in a cancer. And what we found in those patients, that the MSC corresponds to about 15% of all the colorectal cancer, was a truncated form of the chaperone, was inactive, and it was done at the detriment of the wild-type chaperone. So what happened in this patient? So what happened in this patient is that this patient had what is called default in the mismatch repair system. And in the regions that are formed of the repetition of the same nucleotide, that those regions that are called microsatellite, and they are very prone to mutations. So there is one of these regions in the gene HSP110. And this mutation almost always are the lesion. So what happened here in this mutant is that RNA polymerase come here, and then because of the mutation, skip this exon 9, finds a termination codon, and the result is a truncated protein that, as you can see here, is formed at the detriment of the chaperone. And this mutant is completely inactive. So this is the discovery we did at that time. And we found also that this mutation happened in 100% of all the MSC patients. That was not only in colorectal cancer, but also in gastric cancer. So it was the best biomarker until then found. And also interesting thing, it was found at the stage of adenoma, very, very early in the development of the cancer. So this was a patent which was bought by Ipsogen that is now doing a diagnosis kit for MSC patients. So now what happened with the prognostic of this patient? Now, in this world, we did a multicenter clinical study that included more than 3,000 patients, and we could perfectly correlate the amount of the mutant with an excellent prognosis. Really, really good. Excellent prognosis in this case was answer to the therapy. These patients were all treated with oxaliplatin-based treatment. I'll tell you this for after, later on. So, we didn't know anything about this chaperone, so we have to start saying, okay, our clinical studies show that this is a very important chaperone. Until now, that has not been considered. What is the function of this chaperone? We started with intracellular function. Now, what we found first, well, the first thing we did was an approach very general proteomics to see what could so go from there, because we didn't have any idea of all the interaction that this protein could have with other protein in the cell. And two pathways came activated there with HSP110. One was the proliferation, cell proliferation, and the other the DNA repair. Now, for proliferation, we started, as you can see here, HSP110 also always increased in a very important way the proliferation of the cancer cells. And as you can see here, when we deplete in a dose-dependent manner HSP110, we recuperate the proliferation of the control cells. So it has a role in cell proliferation in vitro, but also in vivo when we inject the cells in new animals and we grow the cancer cells as xenografts, what is called xenografts. You can see here that when there is a depletion in HSP110, the cells doesn't grow hardly anything. So it has a role on proliferation, in protein that is very important for cell proliferation is the transcription factor STAT3. As I told you before, when we started that, we didn't know anything about the partners of HSP110, that for the chaperone, sometimes they are called client proteins. So we demonstrated that STAT3 was a client protein of HSP110. There was an interaction between the two proteins. This is called a methodology that is called PLA or Duolink. This is immunoprecipitation, and this is another technique that is called biolar interferometry, and they all demonstrated a very good interaction between the two proteins. This is a modelization that we did of the interaction, and we demonstrated that the interaction concerned the ATP binding, nucleotide binding domain of HSP110. Now, what it did this interaction? In fact, what did that HSP110 binds to the STAT3 and induce the phosphorylation of the protein. In other words, the activation of this transcription factor that then is going to end up in cell proliferation. So you can see here in the dose-dependent manner the proliferation of STAT3, and this is a test of proliferation in vitro, where we met all the recombinant proteins in the tube de Say, and we can see that we find the phosphorylation induced by the chaperone. Now, we used the cohort of patients that we have from the Saint Antoine Hospital in Paris to demonstrate that the HSP110 was associated always with phosphorylation of STAT3 in the biopsies and with a bad prognosis. So really the two proteins were associated directly with bad prognosis. Now, this not explain why the two that we did clinic, well, HSP110 was associated with a bad prognosis because our patients were treated with a chemotherapy, and the result of this clinical study was it's a good prognosis when they are treated. So what is the function really when they are treated, the patient, with this chemotherapy, which is classic for colorectal cancer? which is a combination of 5-fluoroacil and oxaliplatin. They are all DNA-damaging drugs. And why the patients, when they were depleted, the HSP110, they responded to the chemotherapy. Cell proliferation cannot be the explanation there. And then what we found there is that when these kind of drugs, like doxaliplatin, but also many other DNA-damaged drugs, induce the nuclear translocation of the chaperone that goes into the nucleus. And once was there, you can see here, you know, with different times the treatment with oxaliplatin, that goes into the nucleus and 24 hours is accumulated there. Now, if we measure the DNA damage, and we measure that with the phosphorylation of this histone that you see here, it starts here, the DNA damage, and where HSP110 is in the nucleus, there is less DNA damage. This can be seen better here. So you see here, this is the when we deplete HSP110, we don't have here HSP110, and then you can see here at 24 hours, I'm sorry, this is the control cells, what we have to consider. HSP110 is there. So you see here that it goes into the nucleus at 24 hours, and what is the result? That we don't see hardly any DNA damage. And when it's depleted HSP110, of course we see everything, he is there. A same rescue we can see here, if we treat with an inhibitor, this is an inhibitor of the DNA repair, what is called the non-homologous DNA repair. So I'm not going to go into that, but to show you how HSP110 could go into the nucleus after the treatment and have a role repairing the DNA damage that was doing the chemotherapy. So that could explain the why it was associated to a bad prognosis in those patients that were all treated with this drug. So we can see also in the patients, again, with our cohort that we have for us, we could see that there was a good correlation between HSP110 and the DNA damage, and they always measure with this phosphorylation of this histone, that it measures the double-strand DNA breaks. And lastly, but very interesting, we could do a rescue. This is here, you can see in the nucleus with the red pots, all the DNA damage that we can see when HSP110 is not there. This is a cell that is depleted on HSP110, though the chemotherapy is doing a lot of effect. But we can rescue. We introduce HSP110 in the cells, and we don't see hardly any damage. The cell has become resistant to the chemotherapy. Now, this is done for the intracellular function of HSP110, but I have told you that the HSPs can be secreted and have an extracellular function that is immunogenic but immunosuppressive. So bad for the cancer cells. And in this case, it didn't concern the T cells as it was the case for the HSP70. In this case, we demonstrated in this work, I don't know if you can see here, that it concerned the macrophages. Now, to make a very long story and complicate short, there are two types of macrophages. Macrophages that are called M2 and M1. The M2 that infiltrated the tumor are protumoral, and they induce the progression of the tumor. The M1 are antitumoral. And in this case, HSP110 favors the formation of these protumor macrophages. So, of course, the conclusion of the task, we have to develop inhibitors of HSP110, so the patient that were bad prognosis because they express HSP110 become in the class of good prognosis. And at the time that we started this work, there wasn't, as I told you, nothing, so there was not any inhibitors at all known, and even the structure of HSP110 was not known. So this work at that time, and that was in 2014, got a prize, and now we are from MADWIN, which is a consortium of private companies that reward projects that are with a lot of interest for private companies, and they give us the money to do all the structural studies. We could do crystallization studies in collaboration with the INRA Dijon and with the synchrotron in Grenoble. And then we did the crystal, and this really allowed us to do really structural studies. With these studies, that was a lot of work, we couldn't do anything before. So we started with the funds, we have really structural studies done. We could do a first screening of a chemical library. We used a chemical library from the CERMIN, which is the Centre d'études sur les médicaments de Haute Normandie. They have what is called an intelligent library, chemical library, which means that only there are molecules that they have a chemical structure that are prone to inhibit protein-protein interaction. They are called foldamers. And we did this screening initially in silico, and then we tested the ability to block the anti-aggregation property of HSP110. And we came up with three molecules that were very interesting and inhibited HSP110. Now, it was quite specific, eh? Because this is the test that we have in the laboratory to study the chaperone, anti-aggregation and folding properties. We came an enzyme, for example, a luciferase. We do a heat shock, and then we keep the protein to see at the end how much is folded and aggregate in the presence of a chaperone, whatever we want, recombinant, and the inhibitor that we want to test. And we could see, for example, that if we add the HSP70, we didn't have any effect, which means that our molecules were quite specific for HSP110. Now, the next thing was very well studied interaction of the molecule with HSP110. So we did a lot of modeling studies. I'm not going to go into that. But the three of them, in a different way, go into the pocket, the ATP pocket of the chaperone. Maybe the 61 was a little bit different because it was totally into the chaperone in a different way. So it was a stable interaction, and this is different ways of studying the interaction of the protein. This is a biolayer interferometry. I'm not going to go into that in. The next thing was, could these proteins inhibit the proliferative effect of HSP110 and above all the interaction of with his partner, STAT3? And the answer is yes, but only two of them. The 61 didn't work at all, but the other two worked very well and inhibit the interaction with STAT3. Voilà, this is for alpha gene screening. And this is for coin monoprecipitation. You see here, we don't see any more the interaction between HSP110 and STAT3, but only for the molecules 33 and 52. This is duolink and another technique to study interaction of proteins. As you can see, we don't see any more the interaction. And as a result, these two molecules inhibit the proliferative effect of HSP110, as you can see here. We don't see it anymore when the cell are depleted in HSP110. But first, we have very little proliferation in these cells to start with, but there is no difference. The molecules didn't do anything significant. Now, what happened in vivo? The same thing. We have an inhibition of the proliferation, as you can see here. And this happened in a model that has the whole immune system or depleted in the immune system, but has the macrophages. And as you can see here, I cannot see here very well what I have here, but this is a marker of proliferation that is decreased when we have treated with our molecules. You see here, and this is STAT3 that is also decreased. And this is the number of macrophages, but this time are not the M2, which are the bad ones, but the good ones, the M1. The macrophages M1 that are anti-tumoral. Meaning that very probably in the tumoral microenvironment, HSP110 is able to do a shift between the macrophages that are not good toward the good macrophages. And this is to say that we didn't find any toxicity associated to these two molecules, these two promising molecules. This is a marker of apoptosis, which is a way of cell death that we can see increased with our molecule, but this is for the cancer cells. In contrast, when we use the, because all these drugs are used here in our model intraperitoneal. So a very classical way to study the toxicity is to study the cell death in the epithelial cells of the intestinal, in the villus intestinal. And we can see here that we don't see any toxicity. So to finish with this part, just to tell you that we are optimizing these chemical molecules to go from lead to candidate to drug, candidate a medicament in French. And we are doing that with this, we have started really collaboration with chemists that they know how to do this medicinal chemistry because we are not expert on that. So we are working with Dot here in the University of Princeton with this company and in China with an old postdoc of us. Now we are also doing another way of having inhibitor, which is with Affylogic in NAT, and we are developing what are called nanofittings. Now, nanofittings are screening as some sort of alternative to antibodies. They are like nanoantibodies, peptidic, and they bind with a high affinity to different the target. And we have been able to do a first screening that let me show you how, with a nanofitting that is very, very specific. This is the structure of the nanofitting. It's a peptide molecule, contrary to the others that are chemical. And the interesting thing of the nanofitting, other than be very specific and have a lot of affinity, is that they don't enter into the cells, and they have a very short half-life. And this is very interesting for diagnosis purposes, for all the imagery, you know, approaches. And this is a PET scan that we have done with Bertrand Collin in the Fermimage here with IMAPI. And you can see that it's a good marker of the tumor because, as I told you before, HSP110 is very, very abundant in all the tumor microenvironment. So this is the project, how it's gone. Now, let me tell you just a little thing about the other project that was also financed by the ISITA, that was, I think, the year before. I think it was in 2017 before. And this is the thing that in order to detect a cancer, normally on doing biopsy. And in biopsy is a very aggressive technique that doesn't take account of the heterogeneity of the tumor, that has repercussion for the patient. So more and more we are going toward finding something what is called a good marker that can be done what is called in liquid biopsies. No, so this is a little bit the graal now in cancer therapy, to be able to follow the patient only just with a little bit of blood, and you can see if he's answering to the therapy, how he's doing the patient. And let me show you some rosy ideas because they are very interesting. So the first thing I want to tell you is that we found that all the HSPs were secreted through exosome, all the inducible HSPs. Now, one of the HSPs were more interesting for that. It was HSP70, because there is a membrane form of HSP70 that is only found in cancer cells, which means that only the exosome, these nanoparticles that are secreted by the cancer cells, express HSP70 in the membrane. So, in theoretically, we should be able to capture this circulating exosome in the blood, this tumor-derived exosome, using something that captures HSP70. And we developed a peptide aptamer that recognizes HSP70 in the membrane. That it gets like that, transmembrane, with 14 amino acids that remain extracellular. So we target those extracellular HSP70. And let me show, this is just a little introduction for you if you don't know what are exosomes, which are very small nanoparticles of 50 to 150 nanometer of diameter. They are released by all the cells, including cancer cells. They are found in all human fluids, for instance, in the blood. And well, they have a function of intercellular communication, but we don't go here into the function, only the utility for diagnosis purposes. So the key here is to be able in the blood to differentiate the exosome that come from a normal cell from those that come from a tumoral cell. And we propose HSP70. And what we did is that we use a technology for which is the BioLayer interferometry, and we could put here in our biocaptor, we put A8, which is an aptamer that binds to the extracellular domain of a membrane HSP70. And then what we do is we take all the exosome that we purify from the supernatant or from the blood of a patient, we pass to the machine, and it only captures the exosome with HSP70 in the membrane, as you can see here. Now, we validated in this test our aptamer, because here we use an antibody that recognizes this extracellular epitope. It was produced by a colleague and friend of us in Munich, and we could see that the antibody and our aptamer competed both for the same epitope. So we don't see any more signal of the aptamer when we use the antibody. Now, we went ahead and we did, let's start a clinical trial and see if we can find something. We did that with the anti-cancer center, Jean-François Leclerc, and we started a three-year clinical study that was called ExoDiag, that we started the inclusion of patients in 2016. Now there was only 40 patients, 20 with breast cancer, 20 with lung cancer, 40 healthy volunteers, and we were taking really the samples very, very often. The idea was few patients, but we are going to do a deep study. So we took the sample we're taking at the beginning when the patient went to the clinic, and then after each cure. And then we analyzed the sexosome and see what we could find. So the first thing to do was to say, do we have exosome? We started, we take always 5 milliliters of blood from the patient. And first we did ultracentrifugation techniques to isolate our exosome, and we characterized them. Do we have exosome? And the answer was yes, because all the market of exosome was there. And in contrast, this is a market of, you know, of a reticular endoplasmid that you cannot find never in an exosome. And those are specific markers of exosome. Another way to characterize exosome and differentiate from other nanovesicles is by electronic microscopy. And this is a very particular shape, and we have there the shape. And finally, the third way of characterizing this exosome was what is called nanovesicle NTA tracking assay. And what you do here, you can see the size of the nanoparticle that goes used in the size of, for the exosome. And then you can also quantify the number. And then we see what, okay, now let's see what happened. The first thing to tell you is that we didn't find difference between patient and healthy volunteers in the total amount of exosome. So when we do this test, we found more or less the same thing. The size was very variable from one person to another, and the size not statistically is different. So now we are going to analyze only the exosome with HSP70. So a big population of tumor-derived exosome. And what we found here, and what we found here is that we have a big, big difference there. These are the patients. In one lineage, we pulled all the breast cancer and lung cancer, and this is the pulled 7 and 7 of healthy volunteers, and you see that the difference is very, very important. In this case, we separate the metastatic from the non-metastatic patient. And as you can see here, there is a big difference between this is recombinant HSP70, to demonstrate that our captor works. Those are the metastatic on red, non-metastatic on green. So this is a very good market on metastatic. This is only this is just to show you that we can also measure HSP70 by ELISA, and this is to show you that it works much better for diagnosis of metastasis. If we compare with a technique used in the clinic that is called cell search, that measures circulating tumor cells. And this is normal that we have faced, you see here, the area of the, below the curve is much bigger, which means that we have a much better marker and much earlier for the diagnosis. And this is normal because a single cancer cell can release thousands of these exosomes. And now just to tell you that finish with that, which is the patient's follow-up, now we take the same patient and we see the difference in the patient throughout the whole year. And we see the difference. And that worked very, very well. The patient that were respond to the chemotherapy, there was a decrease always in this exosome. When there was no answer, it didn't change. And when there was progression, there was an increase, a huge, of HSP70 exosome. You can see here for a patient that has a breast cancer, and you see here that it stabilized at the end, and the cancer had disappeared. This is another patient, it's in blue, the one that you have to check, that has a lung cancer, and it started to increase, and it has already a metastatic breast, metastatic in the brain. So that's to say, I'm not going to tell you the future that has this, because the future is huge with that. We have started already a work in Besançon, which is called ExoMel for patients with melanoma, on combination HSP70 with PD-L1, which is another marker. You have the poster. I invite you to see that. But we have many collaborations now to do, many clinical trials that we are going to open with that, because the opportunities are very good with the diagnostic. And we have even started a startup that is called Nanodiag, that is incubation in the Centre contre le Cancer of Jean-François Leclerc. This is my team. These are oral collaborations. And I want to tell you that we have had quite many prizes with this project, that we are very happy. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Carmen. I knew that having you at the end of the session would be, you know, to avoid sleepiness. So please, if you have questions, feel free to ask them. And I'm really looking forward to see you also for the poster session. So we have time for questions.
Okay, may I ask the first one?
Yes.
your data on HSP 1 and 1 return are very impressive. So two short questions. The inhibitors, they are available, orally available, or you need to inject?
No, they belong to us. They are not commercially available.
But how do you give to the animals? You inject or you give? No.
I'm sorry. They are not still commercially available, but we produce them, and anybody that wants to use them, we can give them.
Do you have to inject? IP injection or?
IV injection or intraperitoneal. There are not big problems of solubility.
Okay.
But we have to work also in the vectorization, you know, uh-huh. There are many things to do. And what we are doing now with the work in the Princeton University is that they are trying to do for us dual targeting drugs, that the same chemical molecule, for example, target HSP70 or HSP110 in this case, and another molecule, immunotherapy in this case. So we are, that will be a very innovating way, you know, of in therapy, in cancer therapy.
And second question, do you think monoclonal antibodies, again, HSP110 could be a strategy?
That could be. There are not. The problem is with all the antibodies that we have tried, we have not been successful at all.
Okay.
We have spent a lot of money with that, with nothing. And that is why we have started with a nanofitting, to have an alternative to neutralizing antibodies.
Okay.
Because no way to do antibodies that really work. They are very inspecific, they are dirty. I don't know why. There is nothing commercial and we haven't been able to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Is there any other question? No? Okay. So if not, thank you very much, Carmen, for the last talk.
Thank you.
And I would like to thank the audience also.